Good morning, everyone. I hope you all are doing well. I am Divyani, current Vice Chair of IEEE IISc Communication Society Student Chapter, and I will be the host for today's event. I welcome you all for this collaborative event between IEEE Communication Society of IISc and Malnad College of Engineering, Hassan. We have two very interesting talks lined up for you all. The first one is by Praveen Jaykumar on quantum computing 0 to 100, and second one is by Dr. PC Srikant on survival optical networks. Before we start the webinar, I would like to briefly talk about the IEEE Communication Society. Communication Society is an independent society of IEEE since 1972, with over 200 plus chapters in 142 countries. The society aims to provide services for technical and professional advancement, like interaction with experts, access to classified IEEE resources, opportunities, and information. And also, it provides forum for technical exchanges between professionals in academia, industry, and public institutions. We would encourage you all to become a member and avail the benefits. To become the member of IEEE IISc Communication Society, you may please contact me or Varki. The membership is free. Now, without further ado, we will quickly go to the first talk of the day, that is Quantum Computing 0 to 100 by Praveen. Praveen is a senior undergraduate at IISc Bangalore, currently pursuing his bachelor's in physics. He is a KVPY scholar. His interests include quantum computing and quantum communications, with a research focus on quantum error correcting codes. As a member of PNSI Lab DESC IISc, he has participated and completed various related hackathons and challenges. He also blogs about quantum computing and makes quantum games. Welcome, Praveen, and the floor is all yours.
Thank you, Devyani. I'll share my screen.
Yeah.
Can we see? Screen visible?
Yes, we can see your screen.
Hello everyone, and welcome to today's talk. Today's talk will be a brief introduction of quantum computing, and will show you what this field holds. So, what is quantum computing? Quantum computing is when you have computing. Just a minute, I can hear some echo. Can you please check? If you have your audio turned on, please can you switch it off? I can hear some echo. Thank you. So quantum computing is when you take advantage of physical systems to perform computation. So these physical systems are quantum systems, and they have special properties known as superposition entanglement. So this superposition entanglement allows us to parallelly process multiple states, and this is called quantum parallelism. So exploiting quantum parallelism, these quantum algorithms, which many researchers have designed so far, are extremely efficient when compared to classical algorithms. So what are available to us right now? So quantum simulators are systems which are classical computers which simulate quantum systems for us to run simulations and experiments right now. So right now, physical systems like ion traps, superconducting circuits, photonic circuits, etc., can be used to perform quantum computation. These are all quantum systems which maintain quantum states. So right now, IBM, Google are developing superconducting quantum computers. IonQ is a quantum startup, and they develop ion trap-based quantum computers. Microsoft is developing a topological quantum system. And Zandu is developing a photonic quantum system. There are many others. I'm highlighting few well-known ones. So quantum systems are linear, and they follow a linear algebra. So this allows us to be simulate these quantum systems on classical computers. Some Python-based simulators are Qiskit by IBM, which provides both simulators and access to quantum computers, which I'll be demonstrating today. CERC is another simulating software by Google Quantum. And Pengilane and Strawberry Skills are a package, a Python-based quantum computing and quantum machine learning package by Xanadu.ai. So we'll be using Qiskit for the rest of the presentation. So as I mentioned earlier, quantum computing has two important paradigms. One is the superposition principle and next is the entanglement principle. Let's look at superposition principle. So a classical bit or a unit of information can be either zero or one, not both at the same time. So you have a classical bit, it's either zero or one and not the superposition. So a quantum bit on the other hand can be both zero and one at the same time. You can think of them as colored balls. The colored balls is either zero or one, is either red or green, not both at the same time. But if it's a quantum ball, it can be red and green at the same time. It's different from saying there are multiple balls in a bag which are red and green and pick out one. This is like the ball itself is physically both red and green at the same time. So let us represent the state zero by this notation zero. This is called the Dirac notation and which is used to represent a quantum state. And one by the one inside this ket. This is called a bracket. And this superposition is basically a summation, a linear sum of both state zero and state one. So A and B are in general complex numbers. And A and B uniquely define this superposition state. So measurement is like performing, is like viewing the colored ball, whether it's red or green. We're determining whether the given quantum ball is a red or green ball. So measurement causes this superposition state to collapse to one of the classical states, the red ball or the green ball. So it collapses to either zero state or one state. So measurement outcome, the measurement outcomes are zero and one in this case, and it has a measurement outcome of zero with probability A square and measurement outcome of one with probability B square. So as these are probabilities of measurements, these should add up to one. So hence we have this normalization condition A square plus B square is equal to one. And hence this vector A comma B is a normalized vector. And this vector represents our quantum state. So this is for a single qubit. Now say what we have, say that we have multiple qubits, say n qubits. So each of this qubit can be zero or one, and thus we have a larger space of n qubits. And we have a string of zeros and ones, and the superposition of all possible strings. So there'll be a total of 2n possible strings, and a general state can be a superposition of all those. So let's demonstrate superposition on a single qubit. So I'm right now writing this code on Qiskit. So I import all the required libraries, and I import a simulator. So this is a classical simulator. I get this backend call. A backend is basically the simulator system. So I make my quantum object first. Then I add a gate, Hadamard gate. I'll explain what it is in a while. And I measure. So first I have added a Hadamard gate, which basically takes my classical state, which is prepared at state zero, and puts it in a superposition state. And now if I perform measurements and run it as an experiment. So each measurement is an experiment on the quantum state. So if I run the experiment, say 1,000 times, and I get the resulting counts. So the final count is basically either how many zeros or how many ones are there. So if I plot this, I get an equal distribution. So this basically says that both zero and one are achieved with an equal probability. So we can actually run this on an actual quantum system. So using cloud, using IBM Q cloud computing system. So first I load my account, which I've already done beforehand. And we can also list out, so IBM Q's providers. Earlier we had seen that we had gotten a provider from this backend called AER, which is a classical backend. Here we load all quantum backend. Can you mute yourself, I can hear it. Thank you. So now we load a provider, which is basically a access to a computer, actual quantum computer, and I get a provider which is open access, and under the name of IBM Q Manila. So when first I run, I transpile by circuit. So what is transpiling? So right now we had used the gates, Hadamard gate and a measurement gate. But a quantum system, a natural quantum system, is optimized with certain gates in mind. Say, example, X gate or Z gate or any other. They have optimized the hardware for those gates. So this transpiler basically converts my given gates to those particular set of gates. So this transpilation step takes in my circuit and transpiles it according to the basis set given by this particular backend Manila. So I send this circuit, I run it, and I plot the histogram. So this quantum system is quite busy. So we can see the quantum systems on the interface. This is the IBM quantum online interface. This shows me all the quantum devices currently accessible to me. So this is the Manila system which I have used. So you can see that this system has 5 qubits, which has this connectivity. And this has a total quantum volume, which is a measure of how good the system is, how accurate the system is. And right now I have given it one pending job. So I can view my pending jobs here. Right now it's queued up and there are 3 other jobs before mine. So I'm going to cancel this because it'll take time. You can try this on your own later. So let's see. So I had used something called a Hadamard gate and a measurement gate. So these are quantum gates. So the quantum dynamics is linear. The evolution of a quantum state or how the quantum state progresses over the circuit is linear. And these states are normalized. So this kind of gives a requirement which states that the quantum operators which I apply on the state are unitary. So unitary gates ensure that these evolutions are reversible. So hence, only these certain gates can be applied. So these states are normalized complex vectors. So hence these unitary operations are 2×2 dimensional complex matrices on these complex vectors. So on a superposition states, the unitary acts linearly on both the states. So a few quantum gates, the X gate or the flip gate flips 0 to 1 and 1 to 0, which is like the classical NOT gate. The Z gate or the phase flip gate adds a plus or minus phase to the state. If it's a 0 state, it doesn't add anything. If it's a 1 state, it adds a minus phase. The Hadamard gate, which I had used earlier, it causes a superposition when we have an input 0. So when you have input 0, it causes a superposition between 0 and 1. And this state can be written as a plus state. I'm just introducing this notation. And if I use 1 state, we get a state of 0 minus 1 state. And I write this as minus state because of this minus here. So notice that when I do the calculations by hand, I get H equal to X. So these are the eigenstates of X. What I mean by eigenstate is when I... these are the eigenstates of Z, and these are the eigenstates of X. So earlier we had seen something called a measurement, which basically collapses my quantum state to classical basis state. I had chosen a basis state of 0 and 1, but in general, we can choose any measurement state which are orthogonal. So earlier I had measured A plus B, A0 plus B1 at the state 0 and 1. Like I was measuring the quantum ball to be of state green or red. But I can, in general, choose any other basis, like, for example, the plus state or minus state, which I had shown the earlier slide. And this will give a different probability distribution. Yep, A plus and A minus B. So the probability, the result depends upon our measurement basis. So this is very important. And let's see one application of this. So a small application of the superposition principle and measurement principle is the quantum key distribution. So the goal of quantum key distribution is to establish a shared binary string between two parties, Alice and Bob, while protecting the information from an eavesdropper. This is a very common paradigm in quantum cryptography, in cryptography, where we need to share a key between two parties. So the idea is, when the state plus or minus is measured in the standard basis 0 or 1, the measurement probabilities which we get are different from a proper measurement. So we obtain equal probability of measuring plus or minus when you measure in 0 or 1. So we get the wrong results when you measure on the wrong basis. So this is the main idea of what we're going to do here. So the main protocol starts with Alice starting with the transmission string A1 to N. This is the key which she wants to transmit. So she chooses a bit string which denotes her basis states, which she encodes in the she encodes A in the qubits Q1 to Qn. So with this condition, so if B, the basis string, is 0, she encodes A with the basis 0 and 1. So if A1 is 0, she encodes Q1 as 0. If A1 is 1, she encodes Q1 as 1, and vice versa. If B1 is 1, she encodes with this basis, plus or minus basis. So now Alice sends these qubits across to Bob, and without revealing her basis. So Bob does not know the basis which he needs to measure. So he randomly chooses a basis C1 to Cn, and that determines the basis of measurement. So if C1 is 0, if he chooses 0, he measures the state in 0 and 1 basis. So if Alice had chosen the same basis, say 0 or 1 basis, so Bob will obtain the correct answer with full probability. Because they have chosen the same basis, they should have the same probability distribution. If it's the wrong basis, if C1 is not equal to B1, then Bob will obtain the correct answer or the wrong answer with half probability each. So this causes an error in his measurement. So vice versa, if he measures in the plus and minus basis. So we can visualize the basis states over here. If this is the zero state and this is the one state perpendicular to the zero state, orthogonal, the plus state and minus state are also perpendicular, but at a degree of 45 degrees with the 0 and 1 state. So measuring in 0 state, if I have a state plus state and I measure in state 0 and 1 basis, I can obtain 0 and 1 with equal probability distribution. Likewise, if I have state 1, if I measure in plus or minus basis, I can get an equal probability of plus or minus. So this is the main concept behind this. So finally, Bob tells Alice that I had performed measurements in these bases. Alice and Bob publicly exchange the basis strings B and C. So now they compare the strings. The positions where they measured with the same basis will be correct, and they retain those bits. And the bases which they not measured in the same basis, they discard the resultant bits. So hence they retain the bits wherever they're the same. So what's the advantage here? So if this information is physically protected from any eavesdropper and third parties. So the third party eave who wants to find the message does not know the basis used by Alice. So if eave tries to measure, and this will alter the resultant states, because measurement collapses the quantum state and thus will introduce a lot of errors. And this error can be detected by statistical methods. So this statistical method can be performed by sharing some of the output information and seeing how much of it matches. If a lot of bits are not matching, then you can say that the eave has intercepted the message and tried to find out what it is. And thus they discard the bits and they redo the protocol. So here's a small image which I got online which depicts this protocol. So Alice starts with the bit string. Alice chooses a basis state. So the plus state denotes 0 or 1 state, and the cross state denotes plus state or minus state. And these are the polarizations or the quantum states which Alice transmits. Then Bob chooses a random basis state, and Bob measures. And then they publicly discuss what basis they've used, and then they choose whichever basis state matches. So for example, this is Alice's basis state, this is Bob's basis state. So this and this matches. This and this do not match, so they discard the bit. So this and this matches, so they retain the bit. So likewise, they choose the basis state which matches, and they reconcile the bits. So we have seen one application of the gate, X gate, B gate, and the Hadamard gate right now. Let's see a few other gates. So an S gate or the phase gate adds a phase, a complex phase of I to my plus one state when applied. And another gate is the C not gate. A C not gate is a control not gate, and which basically flips the second qubit based on the first qubit's output. So if the first qubit is one, it flips the second qubit. If not, it does not do anything. So a quantum computer requires a minimal set of gates. A quantum computer requires minimal set of gates, and all one qubit gates and C naught is a universal, can be shown to be universal set of gates. So one useful way of representing quantum information is the Bloch sphere. And so let me briefly tell what it is. So a qubit can be written as a superposition, as I stated. So as they are normalized, I can write A as mod A times some complex phase, mod B times some complexes. Both of them are complex numbers. So if I write this and simplify this, apart from the global phase, I basically have cos theta 0 plus sine theta times some complex phase 1. So this hints at representing this as a point in the sphere. So what we can then conclude is, we can represent this quantum state as a point in the sphere given by the angles theta and phi. So theta gives us the measure from the distance from the state zero, because cos theta and sine theta determine the relative amplitudes between zero and one. And phi is like a phi over here denotes the complex phase between zero state and one state. Theta determines the amplitude, phi determines the phase. And over here, phi gives the angle in this sphere. So this helps us represent and visualize the quantum state, the single quantum state. So pure states can be represented as points on the Bloch sphere, and mixed state. A mixed state is a classical collection of quantum states. Mixed state can be represented by points inside the Bloch sphere. I will not go into that right now. We don't have the time. So another important concept which I had mentioned is the entanglement property. So two states are entangled. These entanglement property is a quantum correlation, which is different from a classical correlation. So for example, the Bell state. Bell state is a superposition between 0, 0 and 1, 1. So if I measure this, I'll get only 0, 0 and 1, 1. I won't get 0, 1 or 1, 0 states. So this means they are entangled. Let's demonstrate this. So I take a quantum circuit, which has two qubits and two classical registers. I apply a Hadamard and I apply a C not gate. So this prepares a Bell state. This circuit prepares a Bell state. And I measure the qubits on the respective classical bits. And let's run this now. I'm running this on a classical local simulator. So if I run this with 1,000 shots, you can see that there are superposition of 0, 0 and 1, 1. 0, 1 and 1, 0 are not present. So if I measure qubit 1 to be 0, the second qubit will also be 0. If I measure the first qubit with 1, the second qubit will always be 1. So this is action at a distance. So irrespective of how far the second qubit is from qubit 1, if they're entangled, their final outputs are correlated. So what now, some applications of entanglement entangled states. So these entangled states can be used for quantum teleportation. So transfer of information of one qubit using a Bell path, these can be used to transmit both quantum information and classical information via super dense coding. So another useful application of entanglement states is the quantum error correction. So due to no cloning theorem, quantum information cannot be copied. So hence, we use entangled states to encode classical information using redundancies. And this thus allows us to perform quantum computation with minimum errors. So with the remaining time, I want to talk about this very beautiful quantum algorithm. So this algorithm is called Grover's algorithm, which basically allows us to search a database with a lower number of queries. So say you have n objects in a database and you need to find up one particular object, either by name or it satisfies some property. Classically, you'll have to check every object to find such result. So, but this Grover's algorithm, which is a quantum algorithm, does this with a root n number of checks. So the Grover's algorithm has two steps. One is the oracle creation. Second is the amplitude amplification. So the oracle creation is where I check whether an element is the required result or the required string or not. So it involves a classical function which I encode quantumly. So classical function basically outputs zero if the state which I'm checking X is not the required state W, and which it outputs one if the state which I'm checking X is the required state W. So I convert this classical function into a quantum oracle UW, which basically adds this output to my quantum state Y. So if you take the quantum state as your minus state, say zero, minus one state. Now, if I have such an oracle UW, what it does is it adds one to both of these kets if the state is the required state, and thus this becomes one state and this becomes zero state. And if I take the minus outside, this gives me a case of minus one if it's the required state. So basically, this marks the required state with a phase of minus one. So I can write this as I minus two W, this ket W bra W. This basically is a projector on the state W. So what it does is, I state is the identity state. It basically returns the given quantum state. The W state over here projects onto the, this projector projects onto the W state and adds the amplitude of minus two. So this effectively adds a phase of minus to the W state and does not change any other state. So let's see what happens to this after I mark the state. I mark the state by adding a minus one phase. So first, prepare the state in an equiprobable normalized superposition. So this is superposition of all possible states in the n equal to 2 power the number of qubits space. Next, we perform the Grover's iteration. So first, I mark using the oracle. I mark all my required states. So the marking is done on the required states, and then I apply this operator, which is basically amplification operator. What this operator does is, if you observe this operator structure, it flips our quantum state over the mean of the amplitudes. So this S state is a superposition of all possible states. So if I apply this operator and if I take the trace, I get this as the mean of all my quantum state. You can try this on yourself on paper. So what this operator does, this evolution does, is flips the quantum state by its mean. So after the Grover's iteration is applied root n times, this root n can be derived numerically. The amplitude of the mark state becomes maximum. So I have the input state. I create a superposition of all possible states. I apply my oracle, apply the amplification steps. I repeat this root n times. I measure. So let's demonstrate this. So So I start with a 2-qubit. This is a 2-qubit oracle, which has a total of 4 possible states, which I have to find one of the possible states. So this is the target state which I want to target, which I want to isolate, the 1-0 state. So here I'm making an oracle which marks my 1-0 state. So if it's a 0, I add a NOT gate, and I add a phase by the CZ operator. A CZ operator adds a phase if both the qubits are 1. So by adding a NOT gate to my first qubit, I make this into a 1, I add a CZ, and then I reverse this NOT gate. So effectively, it's marking the 1,0 state. If the qubits are 1,0. So let's run this oracle. And now I do an amplitude amplification step. So basically, this is the circuit. This is my initial state. Then I mark using my oracle. And then I amplify my amplitude by using this gate. So let's measure and see what happens. So as you can see, the state 0,1 is maximum. Qiskit uses a bit reversal notation. So it's actually 1,0 state. So you can see that the state 1,0 is obtained with maximal probability after this one iteration. Classically, you'll have to check every case. You'll have to check all 4 qubits, all 4 strings 0,1, 0,0, 1,0, 0,1, and 1,1 to check which satisfies your state. But here I just require one iteration of my oracle checking. So in the above example, which we had seen, this term oracle was used. So what is an oracle? An oracle is like a black box function, which basically marks my quantum state with whether it satisfies some particular criteria. It determines if the given input is a required target, a string matching. It calculates some hidden function of the input and gives it. For example, we calculated f of wx in the given function in the example. And can be used to mark if the given input satisfies some satisfiability probability. So this hints at solving NP-complete problems. So NP-complete problems are those problems whose solutions are hard to find but easy to verify. So we can use an oracle to verify a solution very easily. So thus, when given a superposition of all possible states, we can simultaneously use a quantum oracle to verify and mark those states which are the solution states. And we can use the amplitude states to amplify those states. So in the given example, we mark the state 0,1. And this can be recast into a logical clause given by x1 bar and x2. And this is the satisfiability criteria. So in general, we can solve this VSAT problem by decomposing my given clause into three clauses, and we can make a circuit for we can make the oracle circuit for such an input and verify. So this is a very important application of the Grover's algorithm. So I'm going to conclude now by just stating few other applications. So this VQE, or the variation quantum eigensolver, is a method used to determine certain eigenstates. So in chemistry and biology, we often require to estimate and predict various parameters of the molecules to study and understand the probability, properties. For example, if we have a virus antigen, or if we have some molecule whose properties like lifetime or bond strength or other properties, protein binding, which we need to study. We need to determine its bond length, the bond angles, and other quantum properties. So estimating these properties using classical computers and algorithms is usually computationally hard. So quantum systems have entanglement and superposition and are hard to simulate on a classical system. So quantum systems like these proteins. So as Professor Feynman had originally said, quantum computers would be better to simulate quantum systems than classical systems. It's crucial to develop quantum computers to simulate these. So an important parameter that determines the stability and various properties of proteins and other molecules are the bond length. of the molecule. So the bond length by definition maximizes the energy of the molecule, and so minimizes the energy of the molecule. So this hints at designing a quantum optimizer, which is parameterized by the bond length and outputs the estimated energy. So we design a circuit which has parameters for the gates, and these parameters are determined by the bond length and other variation parameters. And the output of this circuit is usually the energy. And we run classical optimizers on the side to optimize this energy, to optimize the circuit parameters such that the energy is reduced after each iteration. So this is a variation quantum eigensolver. So few other applications. Matrix inversion by this method called HHL. So in general, classically, to invert a matrix in a classical computer, it takes O n power 2 point something number of operations to invert the matrix. In a quantum, using a quantum computer and using quantum algorithms to do this efficiently, we can do it in much more efficient methods. And this can be done using some method called phase estimation, which is used to estimate the eigenvalues. And once we estimate the eigenvalues in the superposition, we use rotational quantum gates to invert these matrices. So another application is optimization using QAOA. This is a very interesting application where we start with a known Hamiltonian. A Hamiltonian is like a description of a quantum system, and we start with its lowest eigenstate. We start with its lowest possible state, and we have a target Hamiltonian H1, which whose lowest eigenstate we don't know. We need to determine that. So we start with the lower H0, whose lowest eigenstate we know, and we start with that, and we slowly evolve H0 to H1 by changing time very slowly. And adiabatically and following quantum principles, it should remain the lowest eigenstate of whatever Hamiltonian it is at that point of time. So by evolving, by such an evolution, slow evolution, we can obtain the eigenstate of H1. So another seminal application of quantum computing is the Schur's factoring algorithm. So this is an algorithm used to break a discrete logarithm problem and can decipher and get to crack RSA encryption schemes. So I'll leave that to you to explore. So any questions? Let me check the chat. Hello? Hello.
Yeah, Praveen. Thank you so much for the talk. So there is one question in the chat. Is there any way to decrease the error when Bob receives the message without compromising security? I think this was for slide 10 or something in yours.
Yeah, there are classical ways to reduce the errors by the post process. Apart from that, we can also, we are transferring quantum information. So the quantum information itself, we can encode using quantum error correction and other means. We can encode the same quantum information redundantly on multiple qubits, and we can transmit that. So that will effectively reduce the error.
Okay, thank you. Any more questions? You can raise your hand or directly unmute yourself and ask the question.
So I have a very naive question. So when we are transmitting quantum information bits, so what sort of in wireless communication terminologies channel are we looking at? Does it have, let's say, like additive noise, or does it also involve some sort of phase rotation noise, something like that? So how are we intending to transmit from, let's say, the example that you have taken, from Alice to Bob? So what is the link in between is the question.
So the link usually is like something which transmits photonic systems like quantum optical fibers. So they can be used to transmit these quantum information. And the kind of errors they undergo are phase decoherence, phase loss. The phase between 0 and 1 state is lost. The phase information is lost, the amplitude is lost. Like, for example, usually the 1 state is chosen to be higher energy state. So over time and over distance, when you transmit over a quantum channel, they decoher to a lower state, say state 0. So there are multiple losses like amplitude loss, decoherence, phase loss, bit flips. So state 0 can be flipped to 1 and state 1 can be flipped to 0 by random errors. So all of the classical paradigms can be directly mapped to a quantum channel. Apart from the classical errors, we have additional errors in quantum case.
Yeah, thanks. Okay.
So the additional errors is due to the phase. The phase property is not in classical systems, right? So the errors which can occur in the phase is the additional errors.
Okay. So one additional question. So let's say we have a very long channel, or the distance between two transmitter and receiver is too far. So generally what we do is we put some repeater in between, which takes the signal, amplifies it and transmit again. So is something like that also possible here, or does meddling with the information then change a lot of things?
For repeater, so what we usually do in this quantum system is we don't send the information directly in the beginning. So we first establish entanglement between two far off nodes, say Alice and Bob, which are separated by multiple repeaters. So we start off by sharing entanglement between close by nodes, and we do something called entanglement swapping, where say we have three, let me draw it. So say we have Alice here.
Right.
We have Bob, and this is his setup. This is another setup. So this is a one repeater, second repeater, third repeater. So first, what we do is we establish entanglement between these repeaters. So this establishing entanglement between close by repeaters, and at each of these repeaters, we do something called entanglement swapping, where this entanglement is converted to a larger entanglement between this party and this party. Likewise, we repeat for this entanglement, and these two are combined to entanglement between these two. So once we establish this entanglement between A and B, then we can use this entanglement to transmit our quantum state, the required state, using quantum teleportation. So we don't need to send the quantum, the state psi over the nodes. We first establish entanglement and then use this entanglement.
Oh, yeah, got it. Thank you.
Okay. I think we can take the other questions offline later. Thank you so much, Praveen, for the talk. Can we have a round of applause for Praveen? Okay. You can stop sharing now, Praveen. Thank you. Okay. So our next talk is by Dr. P.C. Srikant on survival optical networks. Dr. Srikant is a professor and in EC department in Malnad College of Engineering. He has done his bachelor's from same college and BTech, MTech from IIT Kanpur. He received his PhD from VTU Belgaum. He has deep involvement in photonics and optical networks. He is a recipient of various awards and a member of various societies like IEEE USA, IEEE Photonics Society, to name a few. He is also the founder of Prakash Bharati IEEE Photonics Society India. Welcome, sir, to the seminar, and the floor is all yours.
Thank you, Devyani. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Can you please unmute my video? Is it possible from your side? Video?
Your video?
Yeah. Only I'm not able to unmute my video.
But, sir, we are not seeing your video.
You are not seeing my video?
Yeah, we are not seeing your video.
No, you can unmute my video. It is muted. Devyani?
Yes, sir. I'll just a second.
You are the organizer, no?
Sorry?
You are the organizer, no?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I think you can, it is, you can unmute.
I am trying, sir, just a second.
In the meantime, I'll try to share my slides.
Yes, sir.
Hello, are you please use the sharing option?
Sorry, sir.
I think only meeting organizers and presenters can share in this meeting. So, would you please give me the. I'm giving the.
Getting an option top screen to share screen.
I am not getting the screen to share because I'm a presenter but can share in this meeting, I'm not able to share.
Hey Divyani, it's Aditya. Yes. Can you change the settings in the meeting? I think you can go and change the settings so people outside the organization can present.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can. I've changed his role to determine whether share content have. Make a presenter. Okay. So now are you getting an option?
One second, I'll try once again. Yeah, I'll try to share. Sorry. It's Institute account, no?
Yes, sir. I made you a presenter, so now I think you'll be able to.
Yeah, I think now. Yeah, I think it will share. You can turn on my camera also from your side. Okay.
Yeah, we can see your slide, sir.
Slide is coming. I think you can. Unmute my video also, if possible. I think it's okay. Here, no?
I don't see an option to switch on your camera, actually. If any of the IEEE ComSoc member can help me here, it will be great.
Hello, sir. This is Priya. Can you, like, in the screen, can you show your teams, like, wherever you have joined the meeting from? So maybe from there we can help you.
Pertaining to me?
Yes, sir. Like, on your screen, you have presented the slide. So instead of the slide, can you show us your team meeting window? So maybe there we can tell you which option to choose.
No, actually, I have unmuted my audio. No, in the left side video icon is there. I'm not able to unmute it. That's all. Left side audio video is there. Camera turn on. It is not able to turning on. I think option. It is with the organizer only. Yeah, they have to allow.
Okay.
So there are a lot of things in Microsoft. Normally, if you go for Google and all those things, they are Google friendly. This is Microsoft is a little bit.
Okay. So for time being, we'll start up with the presentation and search.
Sure. So good afternoon, everyone. So thank you, Devani, for my introduction. And today I'm going to discuss about survivable optical networks. What is survivability and how a network can be made survivable after failure? So these are all the things which I'm going to deal with. So I have got a little bit time, so I have to go quickly. So first of all, you know that fiber optic cable, especially in WDM networks, you know that one. Many channels are carried on a single channel, on a single fiber, you know that one. So that means to say that one, optical fiber provides an enormous bandwidth, I have already told, 25 terahertz, low loss, 0.2 dB per kilometer, and very low bit rate of 10 to the power of minus 9, 10 to the power of minus 50. You can see it is 25 terahertz is a small, it's not a small data. If there is a failure of fiber optic link between one point to another point in WDM, you may lose a huge number of data, okay, because of the bandwidth is 25 terahertz. And that's what actually failure of network elements, example, fiber links and cross connects may cause the failure of several optical links, since each light path is expected to operate at a rate of several gigabits per second, and failure can lead to severe data loss. So this is what is happening. Supposing say there's a fiber cut or anything which is between transmitter and receiver. Now coming to this one, there are you know that it's a layered architecture. We can in fact correct in the higher layer only, but in the higher layer, the problem associated with the higher layer is it will take to recover or reinstate the path, it will take in the order of milliseconds, not seconds. But if you do it in physical layer, it hardly takes a few milliseconds, and you can restore the connection which is lost due to many failures. So I think that is what is the survivability. So you can see this is a WDM architecture. You have got there are n number of input wavelengths, and they are multiplexed. You can see they have been carried on a single optical fiber. So if there is a cut in the single optical fiber, you may lose. There are n number of channels, and if you multiply each with some gigabits or megabits or terabits, you are going to lose terabits of data, and that is a big threatening thing. So we need to reinstate the connection loss because of failure. So now, then anyhow, all of us know about it, a preliminary thing, RWA, routing and wavelength assignment. So we need actually to establish a connection, we have to route it, okay? Then a wavelength should be assigned to that particular path. So that is known as wavelength routing and wavelength assignment. So anyhow, that is a very elementary path. So I have already told, what is survivability? Survivability is the ability of the network to recover from the failure of hardware components. So of course, you know that there are lot of hardware components, interconnects, fiber optic cable, then nodes, etc. Common types of failures are failure of node and link failure and node failure. So we'll look into it. So how we can restore. So there are mainly a broad classification recovery. One is proactive and another is reactive. Proactive means already there is one backup path. Reactive means in the event of failure, we are going to search a new path. In proactive path, 100% is guaranteed the restoration. But in reactive path, 100% may not be possible because sometimes you may not get the path which is vacant or which is having no traffic. So in that one, of course, there are proactive and reactive have their own advantage and disadvantage. As you said, proactive 100% is guaranteed, reactive not 100%. But of course, in reactive, we can minimize the cost because in proactive, what is happening is always there is a backup path. Backup path may be redundant many times. So that we need to check it, okay? So then once again, in that one, dedicated, in proactive, you got dedicated, shared backup path. I will tell you later. So I don't have next. Next option is you have got link restoration and path restoration, okay? So next. Yeah, so in the event of, you can see the path protection and the link protection, I have used a 6-node an architecture. You can see 1, 2, 3. So there is a cut between 2 and 3. In path protection, completely primary path is switched from 1, 2, 3, 6 to 1, 4, 5, 6. Complete switching of the path. In link protection, you can see in the second figure, so the traffic is routed from 1 to 2, 2 to 4, 4 to 5, 5 to 3, and 3 to 6. That means it is a link protection. And here what we are using, both the nodes which are failed. That is 2 and 3 participate in this one. Both of them have got their own advantage and disadvantage. Okay. So now, wavelength routed all optical networks. First of all, I'd like to do part one and part two. Two parts I have divided: survivability and blocking probability. You know that one. Survivability is the amount of in the event of failure, you have to reinstate the connection. That is known as survivability. So blocking probability is the reverse of it. That means survivability and blocking probability are inversely proportional to each other. Using the generalized reduced load approximation scheme, the blocking probability and the survivability for the optical network model for two routing schemes is calculated. One is fixed routing and second is least loaded routing. So in this work, I'm going to show you some of the results. In this work, the non-blocking capabilities of the system with full wavelength conversion, limited wavelength conversion, and those which do not use wavelength conversion are compared. So we have got three mainly: no wavelength conversion, full wavelength conversion, and limited range of wavelength conversion. So the difference between these two is that one. In limited wavelength conversion implies a limit on the number of nodes with full wavelength conversion. That means if there are 20 nodes, out of 20, we can have around 8 nodes which has got the capacity to fully convert. That is known as full converter. In the next slide, or you can have totally, you can put the limit on the complete system so that it can change from one wavelength to about around degree of conversion. I'll tell you in the coming slide, maybe 5 wavelengths or 6 wavelengths depending upon the degree of conversion. Okay. The common wavelength assignment strategy is random. So random is in the event of failure, if there are n number of wavelengths, lambda naught to lambda n. So if lambda 2 is failed, you may randomly choose lambda 25, or you can choose lambda 29, or you can choose lambda 82, like that. So it is a random choosing of wavelength. And in the first wave, supposing if it is going on some lambda, first fit means first, if that wavelength is busy or there is a problem with the wavelength, then we go for lambda naught, then lambda 1. If it's lambda naught is not available, lambda 1 will go, that is W1. And W1 and lambda are both are same. If W1 is not available, I'll go for lambda 2. Like that, I'll go till Wn. So this is known as first fit. There is one more thing, last fit. In the last fit, in the event of failure of some, suppose you say lambda I or Wi, I'll go with Wn. If Wn is not available, then I'll go to Wn minus 1. If Wn minus 1 is not available, I will go to Wn minus 2. That is known as last fit. And one more thing, best fit is also there. Of course, we need not have to discuss too much about it. So this is an analytical model which we have done. So this is what each circuit connection uses an entire wavelength channel. That means all the wavelengths we are using. For example, in that one, n wavelengths are there. All the wavelengths will be used. Each in WDM especially, each link has the same number of wavelengths. All links, all paths will have, if there are n wavelengths, all will carry n wavelengths. Each station has arrays of W transmitters and W receivers, where W is the number of wavelengths carried by the fiber. That is one transmitter and one receiver per wavelength. So if there are n number of wavelengths, then we need n number of transmitter and n number of receiver. This assumption corresponds to the optical network architecture proposed by point-to-point traffic. Poisson arrivals, exponential service times, the connection arrivals have the distribution, the average duration of the connection is exponentially distributed. So arrival is exponential, or as Poisson arrival, and the connection after the connection establishment, it is Poisson distribution. If the connection, if it is the, if the connection is block, it is completely discarded. We need not have to go for queue. This is what we have considered independent link loads. Fine. So now we go for what is known as conversion. I already told now there are two things. Supposing, say, if I am going on the if my wavelength is lambda I out of lambda n. Supposing, say, if that lambda I is phasor, lambda I may be lambda 20 or lambda 22. Then I do require some other wavelength. So let us see degree of wavelength conversion. This is what is limited wavelength conversion. You can see in this figure, there are left side 1, 2, 3, 4, right side also 1, 2, 3, 4. You can see degree of conversion, D, number of wavelengths available is 1 more than twice the degree of wavelength conversion. Supposing, say, if D is equal to 1, so the degree of conversion is, 3 plus 1, it is 4, 2 plus 1, it is 3. If D is equal to 2, 2 into 2, 4 plus 1 is 5. That means to say, an incoming wavelength can be at most converted into 5, not all the available wavelengths. I'm telling you, if there are n wavelengths, only the degree is 5 wavelengths, it can convert it into 5 number of wavelengths. So this is known as wavelength conversion. So as you know that this is the formula for blocking probability. From this we are going to find out the blocking probability. I need not have to, because the time restriction is there, I go through the slip through the slides quickly. Have very little time. Okay, so I have already told where W is the number of wavelengths per fiber, T is the average duration of the connection, lambda is the arrival rate on the ith link of the fiber, Li is the average offered load on the ith link of the path, is then Li is equal to lambda I into T, Pk of I is the probability that k wavelengths are used on the ith link of the path. So these are all some of the things which So we have developed our own what is known as empirical formula. Survivability S increases with. So it is directly proportional. Reduction in blocking probability, PNW. We know that one. So when the blocking probability reduces, automatically your survivability increases. Then away number of available channels. If more number of channels are available, then blocking is definitely less. When the blocking is less, survivability automatically increases. That means survivability is directly proportional to number of channels, and indirectly proportional, inversely proportional to blocking probability. Decreases with increase in link load. If the load is increased, then once again blocking will be more. When blocking is more, survivability is less. So that means this is indirectly proportional. That means survivability, yes, decreases with increasing link load, means survivability is inversely proportional to increasing load. In a nutshell, what I am telling you, survivability is directly proportional to available wavelength, inversely proportional to both blocking probability and link load. An empirical formula based on the observation from the simulation result is formulated. Yes, NW, survivability is equal to W lambda into 1 minus P NW divided by rho lambda. So this is the empirical formula. From this formula, we are going to calculate it. So now I'm just going to the results, okay? So in the results, we have plotted survivability versus number of links. You can see that one. So no conversion. For C is equal to 16, you can see the red graph. So if there is no conversion, survivability is very less, because in the event of failure, you will not get the wavelength which can be used for outgoing system, in the system outgoing. In full conversion, definitely, obviously, survivability is 100%. There is no question of losing the connection. But you can see in the limited conversion, in the full conversion, it is shown in green. But in limited conversion, you can see blue, it is almost catching up with no wavelength conversion, full wavelength conversion. That means to say that one, by using limited wavelength conversion, we can almost achieve as good as full wavelength conversion. So why I am telling you is this one. If we use this kind of system, then the cost is reduced like anything. So cost is reduced exponentially if we use this kind of system, because we need not have to use many converters. If supposing say there are 200 wavelengths, in 200 wavelengths, if the degree of conversion if I take is 7, only 7 is sufficient. Instead of 200 wavelength converters, only 7 wavelength converters are sufficient. Okay, there we can reduce a huge cost. Redundancy can be reduced. So another thing. So in this one, you can see survivability for channel is equal to 16, D is equal to 2, load is equal to 7, and number of links is equal to 10. Here also you can see the same thing. The red line, red graph is completely no conversion. So in no conversion, your survivability is very, very weak. But in full conversion, survivability is 100%. But in limited conversion, almost in this particular optimized thing, you are going to get the same. It is an overlapping curve, you can see that one. So that is the advantage of limited wavelength conversion. So these are the things. So I will just conclude this part. This limited wavelength conversion schemes gives better result than the no conversion scheme, and nearly as good result as full wavelength conversion. So this is where we are going to get a lot of, less usage of resources. Redundancy is completely, most of the redundancy is eliminated. The advantage is that the hardware requirement for this technique is less than full wavelength conversion. Hence, it is concluded that the performance improvement obtained by full wavelength conversion over the no wavelength conversion can be achieved by using the limited wavelength conversion. Random selection and first fit wavelength selection, it is concluded that first fit selection is best among these two. So this is regarding the conversion part. Now I am just going to the next part. I am just, so these are the things, there are a lot of things in this one. So I'm just going to, since I did not have time, I should have done total mathematics of this one, that integer linear programming. So we require linear algebra and all this in optimization technique. But now directly, once again, I am going for what is known as the system which we have done in our lab. In fact, this this one. Yeah. See, now I have already told there are two things. One is so this is what actually the hybrid adaptive algorithm. So here what we have used, we have taken proactive and we have taken reactive. That means dynamic and static. So one is dynamic and static. So we have clubbed together. We have used the best of proactive and the best of the reactive. So if you club that one, we are going to get very good results. So hybrid survivability approach that combines the advantage of restoration and protection is considered. Okay, the overall goal of the proposed approach is to improve the restoration efficiency. So this is the algorithm how we have developed. Okay, for example, in the reactive, I am telling you, in the reactive, in the event of failure, we are going to set the path. But in this case, even if there is no failure, we are going to search. Each time we are going to search a new backup path. Each time. Suppose say that searched backup path is asked by some other connection, then we will give it to that person, that connection. Then once again, we'll in the infinite loop, we'll calculate one more backup loop. That means the finding of the backup path is continuously being done once we give that backup path to other connection which requires. So that is the reason why we keep always searching for the backup path. Okay, so this is the advantage of this one, and there is no need for dedicated backup path. That's why we can reduce the redundancy. If you reduce the redundancy, you can make the system optimized in nature. You can definitely make the system very much optimized. Okay, so now what I tell you is arrange the elements of the lookup table in the increasing order of the load on the path. So this is the algorithm which we have developed. Initialize the two indices k is equal to 1 is equal to I, k to keep the track of calls, and I keep to track the LTP. Receive the input call k. As long as LTP is not empty, repeat the steps 5 through 10. Assign the first path LTP to call k. Increment the index I. Store the next optimal path in a standby variable STB. Increment the call counter to accept the next call. I think there is no problem with the current call and no new calls are arriving. Wait for the call. So that's what I told you. Okay. If there is a new call arrived, assign the standby path to this one. So that means we are going to give that backup path to some other. Else, if the call has error, assign the standby path STB to current call. Else, assign the standby path to the new call and the next path. Advance the indices. If the lookup table has no path, print no more paths and halt. So worst case here, you may not get very rarely 100% survivability. But of course, the survivability will be almost on par with the static system. So that means we are taking the advantage of static system. So this is the analytical model we have developed. Yeah. So now, root cost model, link load, rho I is equal to lambda I P plus Bn lambda IL, where lambda IP is the number of wavelengths in the link L carrying the primary traffic. Lambda IB represent the number of wavelengths in the link L in the backup path, and BN is constant to be. Okay, the integrated root or path function PCP for each root, rho is given by PPPC is equal to alpha into mu PL plus beta star into rho PL square plus eta into HPL plus omega into CPL, where mu sigma HCI represent the parameter cost parameter. Alpha, beta and eta omega constant with the which take the values we have given in the table, in the thing which given. I'm not able to see because of the patch which is showing on the screen, okay? So blocking probability for full wavelength conversion, PWCH is equal to 1 minus, so multiplication J is equal to 1 to H, 1 minus QJ of 0. For a single hop connection, only one link, the block probability is equal to that one I have given. So blocking probability for no wavelength conversion, P is equal to sigma SD, rho SD, PSD, divided by sigma SD, rho SD. So this is what actually the blocking probability for no wavelength conversion. So throughput. Throughput is defined as the total number of messages that the network can handle per unit time, and is defined as the ratio of total number of packets sent divided by total input packets received correctly. Throughput is equal to 1 minus blocking probability into lambda, where lambda is Poisson's process, pb is the blocking probability, lambda m is equal to y to the power of m factorial exponential minus y. So throughput finally is equal to sigma summation m is equal to 1 to n m qbm lambda of m, where qbm is a probability of the successful connection establishment. So now finally I am going for restoration time. Tsp is equal to tf plus h into tp plus h plus 1 into tm plus hb plus 1 into tc plus 2hp tp plus 2hp plus 1 plus into tm, where tf is a time to detect the link failure, 10 microsecond. Tm is a message processing time. So like protection delay 400 microseconds for length of 80 kilometers. Tc is the OXC optical cross connect configured time, 10 nanoseconds approximated. H is equal to no hops from link source to source node. Hb is no hops in the backup route. So these are all the things which we are seeing it now. Now I'm just on that one. Yeah, then another thing is channel utilization. So what is channel utilization? So we know that one, how much your channel is utilized. Full wavelength conversion, QFC is equal to 1 minus 1 minus PB dash to the power of 1 by H, whole raised to the power of 1 by W lambda, where PB dash is equal to 1 minus 1 minus P rho to the power of W lambda H. Rho is the probability that the wavelength used on a half, okay? W is the number of wavelengths. So now, no wavelength conversion. So QNC means no wavelength conversion. 1 minus 1 minus PB whole to the power of 1 by W lambda whole to the power of 1 by H, where PB is equal to 1 minus 1 minus rho to the power of H W lambda. So on this basis, we have got both simulation as well as we have got analytical modeling results. So both are in fact matching with each other. So simulation results, a dynamic traffic model in which the connection requests arrive at the network according to Poisson's process with an arrival rate R calls per second is considered. The session holding time is exponentially distributed with more mean holding time. So we already discussed about it. So now, so for this NFS net 14 node network, we have calculated probabilities. So now simulation results. So we are using simulator, that is ONS, which is developed by MIT. So using that one. So without wavelength conversion, let us see without wavelength conversion. So this is load versus blocking probability, no conversion. So first one is you can see dynamic means yellow. In the dynamic means in the event of failure, it is dynamically calculated, and purple is static and hybrid. Okay, this is hybrid. So you can see the minimum blocking probability is there for static, because definitely we have got a dedicated backup path. That is the reason why the blocking probability for this is very less. But blocking probability for dynamic is very high, that yellow. In this figure, you can see blocking probability for hybrid is a little bit lesser than, it is almost lesser than dynamic. So there is an advantage. Some of the cases I will tell you. So you can see here. So in this case, blocking probability on y scale and number of nodes on x scale, you can see that one in the static, almost a very minimum blocking probability, almost zero I can say, but in the dynamic, very high blocking probability. But in this particular case, you can without you can, in this particular case, you can see here in the purple, hybrid is almost on par with your static. So this is I'm considering for no conversion. Remember, no conversion. Hybrid means we are using the advantages of both static and dynamic, but the system is, it is no conversion. So here also load versus packets received. I can see the same type of thing. So you got dynamic is very less, number of packets received, but static is very high, very good. But in between that one, we have got what is known as hybrid. Hybrid is always in between dynamic and static. So this is one more thing, channel utilization. You can see channel is best utilized in static, but in dynamic it is not as much as static, but in hybrid it is a little bit in between dynamic and static. It is always in between dynamic and static. These are also load versus restoration, no conversion. Load versus restoration, you can see the static restoration is very less. We require more restoration time is very less in case of static, but restoration time for dynamic is very high. But restoration for time for hybrid is almost with that of static. So that means to say that one, restoration time is almost catching up with the static. So with wavelength conversion, the same figures with, well, let us see wavelength conversion. So the same blocking probability, the three systems, hybrid system and dynamic. So here also I can see that one, blocking probability for static is very, very low. That is very, very low. That is, you can see purple line, and dynamic is very high blocking probability, but your hybrid scheme will have almost in between blocking probability of static and dynamic. So packet received, so number of packet received, you can see yellow, dynamic very less number of packets received, static you will get more number of packets received, but in case of hybrid it is in between static and dynamic, but it is almost on par with sometimes static, sometimes dynamic. So as we said, like the no conversion also, channel utilization is very low in case of dynamic, and channel utilization is very high in case of static. But the channel utilization in hybrid, it is in between dynamic and static. So now restoration time, we are going for restoration time. Here you can see here, restoration time very quickly. I mean, the event of failure, it should be restored very, very quickly. In dynamic, restoration time is high. In static, quickly it will be restored, but in hybrid it is almost on par with static. That means it is giving good result in case of full wavelength conversion if we are using hybrid scheme. So this is also a graph, blocking probability of number of nodes. You can see here, so dark blue is static. Static has got very less blocking probability. Just above that one, we have got hybrid, that is purple. But the blocking probability of static is very, very high. Dynamic is very high, very high, yellow. So that is the reason why our hybrid scheme works out to be better. Okay. So this is what are the simulation results. So without wavelength conversion, so whatever I have shown previous was analytical results. Now what we are seeing, similar analytical results. Okay, so we got almost identical. So blocking probability, you can see here, hybrid, it is static, very low blocking probability, black. Dynamic, red, it is very high blocking probability, but our hybrid scheme blocking probability is in between static and dynamic. Many cases it is almost on par with we can make on par with the static thing. So now blocking probability, no conversion. You can see static has got very less blocking probability. Dynamic, very high blocking probability. Static, hybrid is in between. So packet received and packets, okay. So load on this one. You can see your static is excellent because it is utilizing more number of packets and it is not dropping, but in dynamic, packet utilization of packet is very less. It is in purple color. And one more in between that one, static. Static definitely is in between. The hybrid is between dynamic and static. So that is the reason why we are going for hybrid. So utilization, once again, utilization, no conversion. So utilization for static is very good, standard utilization. But utilization for dynamic is very less. And utilization for hybrid, it is in between static and dynamic. This is restoration time, no conversion. I am dealing with no conversion. Restoration time, you can see here, is very less for static. That is, I think static is in blue and very high for dynamic. It is in purple and almost it is for hybrid. It is almost with static. So very good results for restoration time if you are using hybrid scheme. So once again, what we have done with no wavelength conversion, now we can do with the wavelength conversion. So you can see static has got blocking probability, very less blocking probability static, very high blocking probability hybrid. Hybrid is, dynamic blue. Static is purple. And red is dynamic. You can see, red is hybrid. So red is almost in between static and dynamic. It is almost on par with, near towards static only. Number of packets received, you can see static has got more. Dynamic has got less. Static is in dark blue, and then dynamic is in purple color, and hybrid is black. It is almost in between static and dynamic. That means to say that one, we are taking only good ones of static and dynamic schemes. This is what is known as full conversion. Once again, utilization, channel utilization, you can see here. Dynamic is very, very low in terms of channel utilization, but static is very high, and channel utilization for hybrid is in between static and dynamic. So restoration time, as we know that one, it should be restored quickly. Restoration time should be less. You can see for restoration, static is very less. That is what blue color, dark blue color, and purple color is dynamic. Dynamic is very high restoration time, but restoration for hybrid, it is very less and almost on par with static. That is the advantage of this one. And you see the blocking probability. In the blocking probability, you can see the highest blocking probability is for high dynamic, that is in purple color. Lowest blocking probability is for static, which is shown in blue color, and the hybrid is in between blue and purple, and it is in black color. It is in between static and dynamic. Okay, so these are all the advantage. That means a compromise between these two. So I need to conclude this one. See, the proposed a hybrid adaptive algorithm for fault tolerance in survival network combines the advantage of static protection and dynamic restoration techniques. Simulation results indicate that the proposed algorithm achieves significantly lower blocking probability, lower restoration time, better channel utilization, better throughput than the conventional dynamic survival optical techniques. So I think if someone wants to do work on this one, so far the survivability is the future work. Calculated using an empirical formula, a better estimation of the survivability parameter is to be evolved considering the remaining parameters such as link load, number of nodes, changes in topology, etc. So this is the thing which someone can do it. Hybrid algorithm can be tested for limited wavelength conversion scheme. So we have done only for full wavelength and no wavelength conversion. For limited wavelength conversion can also be done using this scheme. Okay. So with that one, I think so these are all the publication which we have published using out of this work in our lab. So I think I have done with this one. You have any questions? I think I don't have time already. Your time is over.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I take more of time. I think you can drop a mail if there is any question. Already I have late by 5 minutes. So I think you can conclude. Devyani, thank you for giving me an opportunity to speak on survival of the network. Okay.
Thank you so much, sir. And I would thank you and request both the speakers to share their email IDs on the chat box. If somebody has queries, they may directly contact the speakers. And so you can stop sharing your screen now.
Okay. So I'll give my email ID.
Yeah.
Is it recorded now?
Yes, sir. This meeting is being recorded, sir.
You can, I can give you the permission. You can put it on YouTube. Okay.
Sorry, sir, I didn't get.
No, you can upload to the YouTube. If someone wants, because quantum is very good. Now the friend of the day is quantum. Of course, I'm giving a quantum communication. And if you are interested, you may join on 17th quantum communication and computing. So that is totally a quantum concept and its application. On 17th. So thank you once again. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Okay, we have reached the end of the webinar. So this is a token of appreciation for both the speakers. I would really thank Dr. Srinath for such an intriguing and interesting talk. Thank you, sir.
Most welcome.
And thank you, Praveen, for the talk. We really appreciate the efforts made by the speakers on such a short notice.